Romans chapter 1, verse 15. And we wrap down to the text. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions, or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds. He has now reconciled you in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him, if indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, became an minister. Let's sit down. Thank you. Dear church, it was almost 55 years ago, the same month of February 1962, when American astronaut John Glenn of Ohio made a record as the first human that made an orbit around the Earth. He was on board a spacecraft called Friendship 7, and his mission was, first of course, to put America ahead of the space race during that time. But their mission is also to send man onto orbit to observe his reactions, while on orbit and send him home safely. He was able to orbit the Earth, actually, three times in span of 4 hours and 56 minutes at a speed of 17,000 miles, 274,000 kilometers per hour. Of course, we recognize achievements like this. He was recognized, he became an American figure at that time. And this event marked an accomplishment, not only of the American dream, but of the whole human ambition to reach the stars, to go above the clouds and skies, to find the extent of human will and intellect. And definitely we made a significant progress in terms of science and space navigation. We have landed man on the moon. We have sent the Land Rovers and robots to Mars. We can see and observe planets thousands of light years away. A number of satellite missions are on its way towards bodies outside our solar system. And we, humanity, would like to think that we are to tap our shoulders and applaud one another. We glory in our own achievement. There's a right place for rejoicing in scientific discoveries. There's a right place for that. However, this will never be the reason for us to be puffed up. Being proud is just a manifestation of our own human depravity. Our own sinfulness inside the very core of our heart and soul and being. As much as people would think highly of our human achievements, and as much as we humanists sometimes would glory in the power and strength of our human will and of our human mind and of our human strength, we are nothing but imperfect, sinful human being. That is our nature. Yes. That is who we are. But don't you know, once there was a man who walked on this earth and did not follow any ways of the world. He knew everything and can do anything, yet was not proud and puffed up. He was tempted, yet without sin, was fully man, yet fully God. Yeah. Today, as we continue our study on the Gospel of John, let us remember the great doctrine of the humanity and incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know about this doctrine? Have you profited from the wonder and grace that God Himself walked in this world, and the apostles have seen Him, have touched Him, and have heard Him, that He indeed exists and true? Have you been encouraged that He became like us, truly, perfectly human, and He understands everything, and even our grief, and even when we are heavy laden, yet He is without sin. Therefore, He can save us to the uttermost. Have you filled your hearts with hope? Yes, that true that our Lord is bodily, not in here in this world anymore. But one day, He will come again.
Hallelujah.
Body,
thank you.
Soul, in all His goodness. Have you been giving glory to the Lord because of the gospel that He has given us? That on that cross, Jesus Christ, the mediator between the God and man, was the perfect and most sublime manifestation of the glory and majesty of God. Let us be challenged and glorify God for the preaching this morning. Let us read our text, John chapter 1, verse 14 to 18. John chapter 1, verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about Him and cried, "This was He of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks before me, because He was before me.' For from His fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, no one. The only God who is at the Father's side, He has made Him known." This is the fourth Sunday of our study of the Gospel of John. We have seen on verse 1 that He was the pre-incarnate Word. We have read on Colossians that He is a pre-immanent God. He was in the beginning with God. And we must understand that the Word here is not in any way has any notion of Hellenistic Greek philosophical idea. We must understand this in a Judaistic Johannine sense of the Word. The Word here is that which has the creative power. Same Word in Genesis chapter 1. Our contention here is that Jesus Christ is not just a Lord. He is not just a prophet. He is not just a wise man, good teacher. No. He is more than that. He is, in fact, God. He is the second person in the Holy Trinity. Verse 3, we have seen Him as the agent of creation. He is the creator Himself of everything that was made. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, for by Him all things were created that are in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions and everything in it. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2, on the third phrase it said, by whom He also made the world. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2. And Psalm 33, verse 6 says, by the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all of the host of them by the breath of His mouth. Everything was made through Him. On verse 4, we have seen that He was life, and He was also the light of man. He was life, and when was the light of man? Again, alluding back to Genesis, light, darkness, it's all going back to Genesis. He's the light in this dark world of impurity and ignorance. He's the light, and in Him, there is no darkness at all. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. Now we go to verse 5 to 12. He was rejected by man, even if someone as great as John the Baptist proclaimed that Jesus Christ is indeed the Christ. And the world did not know Him. The world rejected Him. And actually, John is making some comment against his own people, against those Jews. He said on verse 11, his people, the Jews in Israel, did not recognize Him. Praise and goodness of our Lord in verse 11. But our verse 12 pervades those who receive Him, those who have put their faith in Him, those who repent of their sin, to us, believers, He gave us the right of the children. we come to the climax of this great prologue by John. Mm. Yes, the Lord Jesus Christ is God. Yes, He was in the beginning with God. That He is an eternal, all-powerful, omniscient God. All these are true. But in the fullness of time, Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, the word in verse 1 became in verse 14, flesh.
Mm. Yeah.
Became human as we are to fulfill His majestic work of redemption for sinful, vile, and wretched sinners like you and me. But through His grace and mercy, He pardoned us and He saved us. He became flesh, and He became man, yet He did not cease to be God. And He lives among us. He pitched His tent in us. God, Emmanuel, God with us. We not, and John would later on said in this verse, we referring to John, James, and Peter in Transfiguration, first interpretation would mean that they have seen the glory of Christ in the Transfiguration. I will make a case that we, not only them, we have seen the glory of Christ through His, it is perfectly displayed on the cross where He, and on the resurrection. All these attributes and His glory perfectly displayed on that cross. For this morning, may this be our takeaway message. This is a very simple one. The glory of God, my message is this, the glory of God is perfectly displayed on the redemptive work of Jesus Christ, who is both truly God and truly man. I'll repeat it. The glory of God is perfectly displayed on the redemptive work of Christ, who is both truly God and truly man. And we will examine three quick subsections today, this morning. Number one, we will examine His incarnation. Number two, we will examine His glory and His grace. Number three, we will quickly examine His fulfillment of the law. His incarnation, His glory and grace, and His fulfillment of the law. Number one, His incarnation. In verse 14, it says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We are here presented with a very profound truth of Christianity. I think second to the doctrine of Trinity, the incarnation of Christ is one of the most holy and overwhelming doctrine. God be man like us. The Word the preeminent one who is in the beginning with God. How can He became man? However, it is important that we understand this doctrine so as we avoid certain heretical belief. It is impertinent. It is important that you know that, dear congregation, that you know that Jesus Christ is not just only God, but He is truly, very, perfectly man as well. Wayne Grudem says in his systematic theology, it is by far the most amazing miracle of the entire Bible, far more amazing than the resurrection, more amazing even the creation of the universe, that the fact that the infinite, omnipotent, eternal Son of God could become man and join Himself to a human nature forever, so that infinite God became one person with finite man, will remain for eternity the most profound miracle and most profound mystery. Australian man Leon Morris said this way on commenting on this verse: in one short, shattering expression, John unveils the great idea at the heart of Christianity. The Word of God took flesh for man's salvation. And John Calvin said, commenting on this verse, although the evangelist touches briefly the unutterable mystery that the Son of God was clothed with human nature, it is a great mystery. It is such a great mystery. Yet, this brevity, the Word became flesh, is wonderfully perspicuous. Young boys, young children, you know that it is very clear and very simple truth that the Word became flesh. Yes. We can understand it despite its profundity. My first exegetical point is this. When Jesus became man, He did not cease to be God. Mm-hmm. My first exegetical point is, when Jesus became man, he did not cease to be God. In verse 14, it says, he became flesh. The Greek word became here is egeneto. It means became through him. He in turn became flesh. Mm-hmm. It is through his own power and will that he became flesh. God the Father did not create him. That's one of the heresy during medieval time. No, through his own power, he take up for himself the nature of humanity. He is truly God by his own will. His divine nature was not set aside. Instead, while still having the nature of God, he take up for himself human nature except sin. To his eternal deity, he added perfect humanity. Note here also that John uses specifically flesh. He can say man or humanity, but he used the word flesh. We know in our studies in 1 John that flesh, the Greek word for flesh is sarx. It is most of the time negatively expressed. It means the lust of the flesh and all those stuff. But here, John is using the word sarx to fully display that he indeed has flesh. Mm. He can. John himself said, "We have seen him. We have touched him.
Yes.
Yeah. We have heard him. He has a real flesh, human flesh. Mm-hmm. He has real, true human body that can be touched or seen. However, our Lord is truly human in every sense. He was subject to hunger and thirst and weakness and tiredness and temptation, and even death. Yet, he was without sin." Mm-hmm. Calvin said, "It follows that Christ, when he became man, did not cease to be what he formerly was, still God, and that no change took place in the eternal essence of God, of which was clothed in flesh." Mm-hmm. In short, the Son of God began to be man in such a manner that he still continues to be that eternal Word who had no beginning in time. He became man without ceasing to be God.
Yes.
He is man, he is God at the same time. Note here that any doctrine that diminish the importance of either the humanity or divinity of Christ is not an orthodox doctrine. It is not it's not the right doctrine. It is in fact heretical teaching. It is a damning. Mm-hmm. We should have a clear importance. We should have a clear notion of the humanity and at the same time divinity of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Certain heresy are this. For example, Arianism hold that Jesus Christ was not true God. He was man. He's just a man. Mm-hmm. But he was not God. Apollinarianism acknowledge Christ to be God and man. But they hold that he took only the body of a man, not the soul of a man, while his divinity supplied the room of a soul. He just took the body of a man, but his soul is still God. No, we don't believe that. We never believe that. Mm-hmm. And Nestorianism says he grasped Christ both to be God and man, but they say the Godhead made one person and the manhood another person. So this man, Godhead here is. His nature is deity, is divine, and Nestorianism said there's another man, his nature is human, he has human nature, and he has another, he is another person. We're talking about two Christ in here. We don't believe that. And there's another one, Eutychianism. That's why it's wrong. So. It held that one person in Christ, it means that the nature of Christ and the human nature of Christ and the divine nature of Christ is just a mixture. Christ is just a mixture of those two natures. Don't believe that. Mm-hmm. We believe sincerely in our hearts that Jesus Christ is man and God. And I've been repeating this ever since I stand in here, because this is such an important topic. Mm-hmm. He is God. He is man. The Council of Chalcedon responded this following way. So the following holy fathers, we are all one with one voice, teach the confession of one and the same Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, the same perfect in divinity and perfect in humanity, the same, I want you to get this phrase, truly God and truly man, for a rational soul and a body. One essence with the Father as regards his divinity in the same essence as regards his humanity. J.C. Ryle, in his book, Expository Thoughts on the Gospel of John, said this way, using four adverbs, Jesus is truly, perfectly, undividedly, and mixedly man and God. He is truly, perfectly, undividedly, and mixedly man and God. Man and God. Exegetical point number two, Christ residing in this world is an eschatological promise of his dwelling among us. John chapter 1 verse 14 says, the word became flesh and dwelt among us. Other version says tabernacle. He made up his residence. This is kenoo in Greek, to pitch a tent or to live in a tent for a while. Of course, the allusion here is tabernacle. And inside the tabernacle is the Holy of Holies. It is found in Exodus. It denotes the very presence of God. It is kenoo suggests that in Jesus, God has take up residence among his people once again. In a way even more intimate than he dwelt in the midst of wilderness in Israel during Exodus time. He take up his residence in us. He is with us, Emmanuel. Mm-hmm. People have seen him, and he has seen the suffering and depravity of his people and their need for a Savior. He wept with them. He rejoiced and celebrated with them. He taught them and expounded the word of God for them. He performed miracles. He healed the sick. He opened the eyes of the blind, the ears of the deaf. He healed the lepers. He forgave sin. He accepted worship and praise. He was in them, dwelling truly and bodily. God, Emmanuel, living among their needs. Yet they killed him. You know the story. He was crucified, he died, and was buried. He ascended into heaven, but his tomb is empty. His body is not there. When one day he will descend with a shout of angels to judge the living and the dead, and we will be with him forever. That's why we look forward for that hope, that one day we will be with him, body and soul. We will dwell with him, body and soul. The wonder of this is, eskeno is only used five times in the New Testament. First one is in John chapter 1 verse 14. The rest are all in Revelations. Text in Revelation. And I will read to you Revelation chapter 21 verse 3. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among men. One day, this is our hope, that we will no longer sin. Our depravity tells us that we have the capability still to sin, but one day, we won't have any capability to sin. One day, we don't see the physical manifestation of Jesus Christ today. We have his spirit, but bodily, no. But one day, we will dwell with him forever. There will be no more sin. There will be no more death and grief. Everything will become new. Heaven and earth. Beware, we must center our eschatological discussions on weightier topics like hope for the believers and for the coming of the Messiah and fulfillment of everything that was planned, the promise and final consummation of our salvation. These are more important truths. A challenge for us today for this point. The humanity of Jesus Christ should encourage us to fight sin more, as we have a faithful high priest that can sympathize with our weakness. It should encourage us to fight sin more, as we have a faithful high priest that can sympathize with our weakness. Maybe some of us here in this room are tired of our own battle against sin. Maybe we want to lay down our sword and surrender this war against the frailty of our flesh. Please be encouraged, brothers and sisters. The captain of our salvation went through every imaginable temptation. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin.
Amen.
When you are tempted with the lust of the flesh, with the lust of the eyes, with the pride of life, remember that Jesus was also tempted in a much higher scale than we, yet he did not sin. But he understands us. I've read Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. The preceding verse says, verse chapter 4, verse 16, let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in time. We have a faithful high priest who can sympathize with us. Therefore, let us approach with the throne of grace with confidence. Mm-hmm. May I encourage you, therefore, dear church, dear congregation, to approach the throne of grace in prayer. Mm-hmm. The promise is we will receive mercy and find grace.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the hymn, mm-hmm. What a friend we have in Jesus, mm-hmm. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Heavy trials and temptation, is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Mm-hmm. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrow share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Church, there is a promise. Let us continue this battle against sin. Let us fall and be confident. Let us approach the throne of grace with mercy.
Yes.
So that we may receive mercy.
Mm-hmm.
Second point, we not only see his incarnation, we also see his glory and his grace.
Mm-hmm.
Not only we can see here the glory and grace of God, which is showered before us, it says in preceding verses, grace upon grace. Verse 14, we have seen the glories of the Holy Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. Norman Geisler commenting on this, it is the glory of Jesus. Jesus pitched his tabernacle among us, hearkening us back to the Old Testament of Israel wilderness wanderings. God's people had been instructed to erect the tabernacle as a reminder that God's dwelling place was among them. John's use of the Greek word eskenoo, which we discussed a while ago, becomes even more significant when it realized that the glory that resulted from the tabernacling of God is the glory of God, the Shekinah of God, a word that refers to the radiance and the glory or presence of God dwelling in the midst of his people. We have seen his glory. We have seen the glory of the Holy Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. It is also an allusion to the second giving of the law in Moses, Exodus chapter 33, verse 18 to 23. And I've discussed this during the lecture last January. It is an allusion to Moses asking the Lord, requesting the Lord, Lord, show me your glory. Lord, show me your the entirety of your goodness. Of course, the Lord will not allow that. He will definitely be killed. Exodus chapter 33, verse 18 says, Moses said, please show me your glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim before you my name, the Lord, capital L-O-R-D, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. But you cannot see my face, for man shall not see my face and live. And it's also repeated in Exodus chapter 34, verse 5 to 9. The Lord ascended in the cloud and stood with him there, and proclaiming the name of the Lord, proclaiming Yahweh, the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, Yahweh, the Lord, a God merciful, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands of generations, forgiving iniquity, transgression, and sin, but with no means will clear the guilty. My first point here is this, the complete manifestation of God's glory is in his attributes. Show me your glory, And the Lord passed before him. And what did Moses saw? The Lord is good. The Lord is merciful. The Lord is full of grace and truth, full of mercy, and full of justice and wrath against sin. That's my first point. The second point is this. The complete manifestation of God's attribute is perfectly displayed on the cross of Christ. Do you want to see the wrath of God? It is on the cross. Isaiah 53 verse 10 says, the Lord pleased to crush him. Do you want to see the justice of God? It's on the cross. Romans chapter 3 verse 23 to 25. All have sinned and fallen short of his glory, and all are justified by his grace as gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, God's justice, because in divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. Therefore, he is just and justifier. Do you want to see God's forgiving love on the cross? 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 5 says, for there is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. You want to see God's holiness on the cross? We can see here when Christ cried out before the Holy Father, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because he, at that point in time, took up for himself the sinfulness of all humanity. He who knew no sin became sin. Do you want to see God's wisdom and power? Look unto the cross. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 23-24. We preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to us believers, to us who are called by God, who receive mercy, to us it is both the wisdom of God and the power of God. Yeah. Do you want to see God's goodness on the cross? You can see it on the cross. Yeah. Behold, what manner of love is this, that we are called children of God. Yes. Do you want to see God's grace? Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. That's why he deserves all the glory.
Yes.
That's why he deserves all the praise. Yes. That's why we crown him with many crowns. That's why we praise him with everything. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him. Crown him Lord of all. His glory is perfectly displayed on the cross.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah.
From verse 16, his fullness we receive grace upon grace. Grace upon grace upon grace. Have you seen the glory of the Lord? This is my challenge this morning. Have you seen the glory of the Lord as displayed in the redemptive work of Christ? Have you seen his glory? His glory is in the cross. If not, can you consider this moment, this time, this moment itself, the gospel is being preached to you again. And it is another chance, another call for grace for you. Mm-hmm. If you are not with Christ, I urge you, call upon the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. Call upon him. Call upon him. Not only we have seen his incarnation, not only we have seen his glory and his grace, we have seen his fulfillment of the law. For the law was given through Moses. Verse 16, for from his fullness we have received grace upon grace. Verse 17, for the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. The only God who is at the Father's side, he has made him known. We should note here that the contrast is not between the gospel and the law. There are other texts that discuss that. The wording here is especially of truth, again, must be understood not in any Greek or Hellenistic philosophical idea, but in Johannine sense, in Judaistic sense. Truth is fulfillment. Law was given by Moses, who was, of course, deeply respected by the Jews during even until now. Moses has written the first five books of the Bible called the Pentateuch. It's Genesis until the last Deuteronomy, it contains the stories that typified Christ or shadow Christ of what will happen when the Lord saves them. It is he wrote everything that is a shadow of what is coming. But John here, John the writer, is inaugurating a new time in redemptive history by which all that Moses was talking about, all shadows and forms that Moses was talking about in the Old Testament has been fulfilled in Christ. Luke chapter 24 verse 26 says, the story, Jesus Christ just recently resurrected, and his two disciples on his way to Emmaus, and they were discussing about the law and the prophets and all the recent events that was happening during that time, and Christ was immediately beside them, and he was explaining all the law and the prophets, and it says in here in Luke 24 verse 26, was it not necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and then to enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was written in the scriptures about himself. John Gill, the commentator, says truth not only because it contains truth, it is true, and nothing but the truth, it is true. It is coming from the God of truth and the substance of it being Christ, who is the truth and being revealed, applied and led by the Spirit of truth. But because it is not those definitions, but it is because of the fulfillment of those types and substances of the shadows of the law of Moses. Colossians chapter 2 verse 17, for your further study, the shadows were in the law, but the body is in Christ. The whole nation of Israel has been looking for a Sabbath rest, but their fulfillment is in Christ, who gave them rest. Israel is looking for the manna, but was not satisfied. The bread from heaven came down, that those who eat him, those who have intimate relationship with him, will never hunger. Israel longed for a temple. The Lord will. Israel was on the desert, and when they were beaten by snakes because of their sin, Moses had to raise a brazen rod of snake. Christ was raised on the cross for the salvation of everyone.
Yes.
When the angel of death killed all the firstborn of Egypt, Israel has to kill a Passover lamb so that its blood will be splintered on the lintel of the doors, and the angel of death will not kill those inside those house. They will not suffer the wrath of God. On the New Testament, we will not suffer the wrath of God because he is our Passover lamb. Israel has to offer a lamb to a high priest for their sins. But Christ offered himself. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world.
Yes.
He's not only the victim, he's not only the offer, he is also our high priest, interceding for us. And verse 18, and that is what he is telling us. He has made him known. Jesus Christ as making the God the Father known. He is explaining to us all the things that was in the law, that was written by Moses, and its fulfillment in Jesus Christ. He was exegeting the Lord himself. A challenge for us. And all that happens during the incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our challenge for us is this. Let us glory in the incarnation of our Lord, that he is truly God. He is truly man. He is perfectly God. He is perfectly man. He is very God and very man. John Blanchard said, the Puritan said it this way, the Son of God became the Son of Man in order that the sons of man and become the sons of God. The Son of God became the Son of Man in order that the sons of man have become the sons of God. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God and helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness is called by the ones he came to save. That on the cross as Jesus died, he died because he has his body. The wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid here in the death of Christ. And the church, may this message, the glory of God is perfectly displayed in the redemptive work of Jesus Christ, who is both truly God and truly man, be true to our hearts. Let us remember his incarnation. Let us remember his glory and his grace. And he has also fulfilled all that was written in the law. Let us pray.